Dialer Ghost by Eva Ibbotson, read by Morwenna Banks. The Wilkinson family became ghosts quite suddenly during the Second World War when a bomb fell on their house. The house was called Rest Haven, and you couldn't have found a nicer place to live. It had bow windows and a blue front door and stained glass in the bathroom and a garden with a bird table and a lily pond. Mrs. Wilkinson kept everything spotless. Her husband, Mr. Wilkinson, was a dentist, and they'd a son called Eric, who was 13 when the bomb fell. He was a scout and had just started having spots and falling in love with girls who sneered at him. Also living in the house were Mrs. Wilkinson's mother, a fierce old lady with a dangerous umbrella, and Mrs. Wilkinson's sister, Trixie, a pale, fluttery person to whom bad things were always happening. The family had been getting ready to go to the air raid shelter at the bottom of the garden. Grandma took her umbrella and her gas mask case. Mrs. Wilkinson gathered up her knitting and unhooked the budgie's cage. And Eric took a book called Scouting for Boys and the letter he was writing to a girl called Cynthia Harbottle. In the hall, they met Mr. Wilkinson, who'd just come in and was changing into his uniform. He belonged to the Home Guard, a band of part-time soldiers who practiced crawling through the undergrowth and shooting things when they'd finished work.
"Hurry up, everyone," he said. "The planes are getting closer."
But then they remembered poor Trixie was still in her bedroom wrapped in a flag. It was her costume for a show the Women's Institute was putting on. Trixie had been chosen to be the Spirit of Britain in a Union Jack.
"I'll fetch her,"
said Mrs. Wilkinson, who knew Trixie hadn't been happy with the way she looked and might be too shy to come down. She began to climb the stairs, and then the bomb fell, and that was that. It was a shock realising they'd become ghosts. Still, there they were, a bit pale and shimmery, but not so different from before. Grandma always wore her best hat to the shelter with the cherries on, and the whiskers on her chin stuck out like daggers in the moonlight. Eric was in his scout uniform. Only the budgie didn't look too good. He'd lost his tail feathers and seemed to have become rather small.
"Oh, Henry, what shall we do now?" asked Mrs. Wilkinson.
The top half of her husband was dressed like a soldier in a tin hat draped with leaves to make him look like a bush, but the bottom half was dressed like a dentist, and Mrs. Wilkinson, who loved him very much, glided close to him and looked up into his face.
"We shall do what we did before, Maud," said Mr. Wilkinson. "Live decent lives and serve our country."
"At least we're together," said Grandma.
But then a terrible silence fell as the spectres looked at each other.
"Where's Trixie?"
faltered Mrs. Wilkinson. Where indeed? They searched what was left of the house and garden. They called and called, but there was no sign of a shy spook dressed in a flag. For Maud Wilkinson, this was an awful blow.
"I promised Mother I'd look after her," she wailed. "I've always looked after Trixie."
This was true. Maud and Trixie's mother had run a dancing school, and ever since they were little, Maud had helped her nervy sister to be a sugar puff or baby swan. But there was nothing to be done. Why some people become ghosts and others don't is a mystery no one has ever solved. The next years passed uneventfully. The war ended, but nobody came to rebuild their house, and the Wilkinsons lived in it much as before. It was completely ruined, but they could remember where the rooms were, and in a way, being a ghost is simple. You don't feel the cold or have to go to school, and they soon got the hang of passing through walls and vanishing. Having Mr. Wilkinson to explain things was a great help.
"You have to remember," he said, "that while people are made of muscle and bone, ghosts are made of ectoplasm."
But they never forgot Trixie. Every evening as the sun went down, they went into the garden and called her. They called her from the north, from the south and the east and the west, but the sad, goose-pimpled spook never appeared. Then, when they'd been phantoms for about 15 years, something unexpected happened. They found the ghost of a lost child. They were out for an early morning glide in the fields when they saw a white shape lying under a hedge.
"Do you think it's a passed-on sheep?" asked Mrs. Wilkinson.
But when they got closer, they saw it was the ghost of a little girl. She wore an old-fashioned nightdress with a ribbon round the neck and one embroidered slipper, and, though she was fast asleep, the string of a rubber sponge bag was clasped in her hand.
"She must be a ghost from olden times," said Mrs. Wilkinson. "She looks wet," said Grandma.
This was true. Drops of water glistened in her long hair, and her one bare foot looked damp.
"Oh, perhaps she drowned,"
suggested Eric. Mr. Wilkinson opened the sponge bag. Inside was a toothbrush, a tin of tooth powder with a picture of Queen Victoria on the lid, and a fish. It was a wild fish, not the kind that lives in tanks, but it too was a ghost and could tell them nothing.
"It must have floated into the sponge bag when she was in the water," said Mr. Wilkinson.
The thing to do now was wake the child, and this was difficult. In the end, it was the budgie who did it, saying,
"Open wide."
He'd learnt to say this when his cage hung in the dentist's surgery.
"Oh, the sweet thing," cried Mrs. Wilkinson as the child stirred. "Isn't she a darling? I'm sure she's lost. She must come and make a home with us, mustn't she, Henry? We must adopt her." She bent over the child. "What's your name, dear?"
The girl's eyes were open now, but she was still not properly awake.
"Adopt her," she repeated. "Adopt her," said Mrs. Wilkinson. "That's odd, but very pretty."
So that was what she came to be called, although they called her Addie for short. She never remembered anything about her past life, and Mr. Wilkinson, who knew things, said she'd had concussion, which is a blow on the head that makes you forget your past. Mr. and Mrs. Wilkinson never pretended to be her parents. She called them Uncle Henry and Aunt Maud, but she hadn't been with them for more than a few weeks before they felt she was the daughter they'd always longed for and the greatest comfort in the troubled times that now began. Because life became very difficult. Their house was rebuilt, and the people who moved in were the kind that couldn't see ghosts. They thought nothing of putting a plate of scrambled eggs down on Grandma's head or running the Hoover through Eric. And when they left, another set of people moved in who could see ghosts, and that was worse. Every time any of the Wilkinsons appeared, they screamed and fainted, which was terribly hurtful.
"I could understand if we were headless," said Aunt Maud. "Or blood-stained," agreed Grandma. "But we've always kept ourselves decent."
Then the new people started talking about getting the ghosts exorcised, and there was nothing for it. They left their beloved rest haven to find another home. The Wilkinsons went to London thinking there'd be lots of empty houses there, but this was a mistake. It was absolutely packed with ghosts. Ghosts in swimming baths and ghosts in schools, ghosts whooping about in bus stations, ghosts in factories and offices playing about with computers, and older ghosts too, from a bygone age. Knights in armour wandering around Indian takeaways, wailing nuns in toy shops. In the end, the Wilkinsons found a shopping arcade which didn't seem too crowded. It had all sorts of shops in it, shoe shops and grocer's shops and sweet shops and a bunion shop, which puzzled a doctor.
"Can you buy bunions, Aunt Maud?"
she asked, looking at the big wooden foot in the window with a leather bunion nailed to one toe.
"No, dear. Bunions are nasty bumps that people get on the side of their toes. But you can buy things to make bunions better, like sticking plaster and ointments."
But the bunion shop was already haunted by a frail ghost called Mr. Hoffman, a German professor who'd made himself quite ill looking at the bowls for spitting into and the wall charts showing what could go wrong with people's livers. So they went to live in a knicker shop. A doctor called it the knicker shop, but of course no one can make a living just by selling knickers. It sold pyjamas and swimsuits and nightdresses and vests, but none of them were like the pyjamas and swimsuits and vests the Wilkinsons were used to.
"In my day, knickers were long and decent, with elastic at the knee and pockets to keep your hanky in," grumbled Grandma. "And those bikinis! Oh, I was 25 before I saw my first tummy button. Shameless, I call it.
It's the children I'm bothered about, said Aunt Maud. They shouldn't be seeing such things. Still, they tried to make a life for themselves. A doctor was put to sleep in the office, and Uncle Henry stayed among the socks, because there's a limit to how silly you can get with socks. They hung the budgie's cage beside the Wonder Bras and told themselves they were lucky to have a roof over their heads. But they weren't happy. They missed the garden at Rest Haven and the green fields, and although they went out and called Trixie every night, they couldn't help wondering whether a shy person dressed in a flag would dare to appear in such a place. Aunt Maud did everything she could to make the knicker shop a proper home. She arranged cobwebs on the ceiling and rubbed mould into the walls, but the lady who sold the knickers was a demon with the floor polisher. She was another one who couldn't see ghosts and was forever barging through them or spinning the poor budgie round as she twiddled the Wonder Bras. Grandma was getting bothered about Mr. Hoffman in the bunion shop, who was coming up with more and more diseases, and Eric had started counting his spots again and writing awful poetry to Cynthia Harbottle.
But Eric, we've been ghosts for years, his mother would cry. Cynthia would be a fat old lady by now.
But this only hurt Eric, who said that to him she'd always be young, and he'd glide off to see if he could find anything to rhyme with Cynthia, or Harbottle, or both.
Oh, Henry, do you think we'll ever have a proper home again?
Poor Maud would cry. And her husband would tell her to be patient and never let on that when he was pretending to go to the dental hospital to study new ways of filling teeth, he was really house hunting and had found nothing at all. But Aunt Maud's worst worry was a doctor. Addie was becoming a street ghost. She was mixing with completely the wrong sort of ghost. The ghosts of rat catchers and vulgar people who swore and drank in pubs. And she was bringing in the most unsuitable pets. Addie had always been crazy about animals. She liked living animals, but the ones that held her heart were the creatures that had passed on and become ghosts and didn't quite understand what had happened. But it was one thing to fill the garden at Rest Haven with phantom hedgehogs and rabbits and moles, and quite another to keep a run-over alley cat or a battered pigeon among the satin pyjamas and leotards.
Please, dear, no more strays, begged Aunt Maud. After all, you have the budgie and your fish.
But though she wouldn't have hurt Aunt Maud for the world, Addie couldn't help feeling that a bird who said nothing but open wide wasn't very interesting. Nor was her fish much fun. A doctor longed for an exciting pet, something unusual. So she began to haunt London Zoo. And it was on the way back from there one night that she saw something that was to change all their lives. She'd had her eye on a duck-billed platypus which hadn't looked at all well. Of course, she knew that even if it died, the duckbill wouldn't necessarily become a ghost. Animals are the same as people. Some become ghosts and some don't. Even so, as she glided towards its cage, a doctor was full of hope. But a great disappointment awaited her. The keeper must have given the duckbill some medicine, because it looked much better. In fact, it was lumbering round the cage like a 2-year-old, eating a worm. Perhaps it was because she was so sad that she took a wrong turning on the way home. She was about to turn back when she saw a sign above a tall grey house. It was picked out in blue electric lights, and it said, Adopter Ghost.
That's extraordinary, Addie said. That's my name. I'm a doctor, and I'm a ghost.
She stared at the letters.
Is it my house? She wondered.
But that didn't seem likely. Could there be 2 adopter ghosts in the world? Was this the home of a queenly spook with trailing dresses ordering everyone about? But when she peered through the windows, the rooms looked rather dull. Offices with files and a desk and a telephone. A queenly spook would never live in a place like that. Excited, Addie hurried home.
Aunt Maud, you must come, she said. I've seen the most amazing thing. Addie, it's bedtime. They'll be opening the shop soon. Please, begged a doctor. This is important.
So Maud came, and she was quite as excited as the child had been.
My dear, it doesn't say adopt a ghost. Look carefully. It says adopt a ghost. It's an agency to find homes for people like us. Look, there's a notice. Ghosts wanting to be rehoused should register between midnight and 3 a.m. on Tuesdays, Thursdays, or Saturdays.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.